So what you want? One bourbon, one scotch, one beer. Well, I ain't seen my baby since I...
Hi, folks. Kevin from the Rhino here again in Missoula, Montana. Although we are not in Missoula, Montana right now. We are in Big Fork, Montana. Jason, who's normally does the talking at the beginning here, had something else going on today. He'll be in the next one. We are in Big Fork, Montana right now at Whistling Andy's, and we have Brian and Gabe with us right now. Brian is the proprietor here, and you have been around the longest in Montana right now. So when did you get started?
We opened to the public New Year's Eve 2010.
Okay.
And the project took me about 7 years to put together before that. So originally, when we were trying to start it, it was still illegal in Montana to have a craft distillery, so I had to wait for some legislation to get passed, and find a building, and do the construction, and get everything rolling.
Well, great. And I know that one of your most popular and well-known products that you had, and it might have been one of the first ones that you had out, was your hibiscus coconut rum. Tell us a little bit about that.
Correct. So our rum we make from blackstrap molasses that we get out of Louisiana, and
nice.
It's true first cut raw cane sugar that we get from Colombia. So kind of my blend between a Martinique agricole style rum and a Dominican blackstrap base.
Oh, wow.
And then we steep in dried hibiscus flowers that we get from a tea company. In the beginning, my wife was buying coconuts and having me crack them and drain the water out. Besides being very tedious when you're doing a thousand bottles at a time, I couldn't filter all the fat out. So we actually found a company that takes organic coconut milk and spins it in a centrifuge to separate the fat out and ships it up to us.
All right. Well, let's get into it from the beginning. Gabe, please tell folks what it is that you do here.
Hi guys, my name's Gabe. I am the distiller here at Whistling Andy. Been here a little over 5 years now. We make 11 different things here at the distillery. We got our Harvest Select whiskey, our straight bourbon, and then we got a couple of new things that'll be out here very soon that we're going to taste today.
Oh, and we've tasted some of that stuff that's come out of the... That they brought out of the barrel to give us a chance to try, and they are wonderful.
Absolutely.
So please, Gabe, what do we go ahead? Let's pour the first one, and what do we have?
We're gonna taste our Harvest Select. So this is at 80 proof. When we go in a barrel, we actually put everything at 110 to age. So this one, this one's always kind of been special to me. It's arguably my personal favorite spirit that we make.
So what style of whiskey is this?
So it's American style whiskey. A lot of times American style whiskeys are heavy on the corn and rye. So we flipped that mash bill around and went heavy barley, heavy wheat. So it's got 40% barley, 40% wheat, 15 corn, and 5 rye.
Wow, okay.
And a little softer, a little more delicate. I love giving this one to anybody that, if you like Irish or Canadian whiskeys, it's a really fun one to give them because it has similar flavor profiles. So something that you'd kind of recognize, but a lot of different flavors in there too.
So when I think of Irish or Scotch blends, I think barley and wheat. Mm-hmm. So with American blends, so you're also adding in rye and adding in corn. So it's an American blended style whiskey.
Yep. So yeah, we took a standard American mash bill and just flipped it. So typically, I love how the softening component of wheat in a whiskey, but 100% wheat whiskeys, at least for me, tend to be a little flat on the back of the palate. So with everything we do, we're really trying to go for balance in all of our stuff. So we wanted that really fruity, vibrant nose, and then some lingering on the palate there.
So what are we getting out of the nose here now? What are you guys getting?
I'm always like, it's like a dry, like a raisiny, nutty.
Okay.
So I am the worst with descriptors, and I've actually had this.
Be a while.
Well, I've had this discussion with several distillers around the world, and I've met a couple other people like that. I tend to, it's weird. I like smell and taste and color. Like those are my reference points,
okay,
as opposed to like, you know, black currant
them?
And everything. I
no,
I
there's
don't
a
know.
Term for that. They're smelling colors.
It's really weird.
No, it's I met a guy who's a distiller in Scotland who has the same thing too.
Interesting. So it makes having conversations about our stuff
synesthesia?
Really difficult.
Is it synesthesia? Is
it?
That it?
Okay.
I'm okay.
Yeah,
it's something like that. This is nice. It's lovely. It is. It's smooth, but it's got some rough edge at the end, which, you know, I really like a whiskey that's got edges to it. So it's got a little spice there on the end too, which is nice. So this is easy drinking, but I like it as standalone. I could see this sitting outside next to Flathead Lake. Right around dusk, being able to enjoy some of this.
Yeah, absolutely. Really fun in mules. We do a variation on an old fashioned with agave nectar, and agave nectar plays really well with this. It's got that kind of grassy, earthy notes to it that the agave really
more so than
plays
a simple syrup.
So, yep.
Wow. Okay.
And
we've been doing a barrel aged old fashioned at the Wino. And I've been trying to think of how we can change it up each time we use a different barrel with it. And that sounds great.
Agave plays really well with this. You want a whiskey that does have those earthy, grassy notes. And then with our bourbon, we play around with it with maple syrup. And that,
well, let's go on to the next one.
Yeah.
That's a nice starter. This is kind of what I call a palate igniter to get everything going.
So this is our straight bourbon. So kind of the fun thing is, you know, being around 10 years, we're able to let our whiskey sit longer. So, you know, the harvest 5 years ago, we were pulling that harvest select out at just over 2 years.
Mm.
So now we're employing less than three. The bourbon, when I, you know, first started here a little over 5 years ago, we were pulling it right at three. Now we're actually getting closer to pulling them at 4 years. So with the ability to put up more whiskey, we're able to let that sit longer. So
that's great.
Yeah. So
yes, please put more age on those.
It's very exciting.
Oh, we want
sure.
to. It's yeah. I often get asked if we have any really long ones going around. We do another one that we'll taste here in a little bit. But being a totally self-funded, bootstrapped operation. It's.
Yeah.
I love to have things up for a lot longer, but they're quite expensive.
You've got to be pretty well loved in this town.
Yeah,
I would
absolutely hope so.
All right, so this. What are we getting out of this for the nose? What are you getting?
Definitely, it's the nose is 100% different from the harvest select.
It's almost like a waxiness in there.
Yeah, it's very, very earthy. The bourbon is the more, you know, the bourbon is the more popular of the two.
But there's some sweetness in there. There's almost like a spicy toffee kind
of
on there.
That's a good, yeah.
So we're a little lower in corn on our mash bill. We're 60% corn. And
okay.
Then barley, wheat, and rye as well. So 4-grain bourbon. Once again, I'm trying to go for balance throughout. A lot of the bourbons that, at least for my palate, that are 75% to 80% corn tend to be that big sweet hit right up front, and then nothing on the back. I like those, and certain times they're fantastic.
Oh,
but
yeah. This has got also notes of brown sugar,
mm-hmm,
too. So let's give this a taste.
You definitely get, like, the corn comes through pretty prevalent, but
it is
like a nutty corn.
easy, very easy, smooth, easy drinking. It's got a nice finish on it. It's a nice little spice and dryness on it. That's really nice too. But yeah, sweet. This is easy drinking. So what's the proof on this one?
That we do at 80 proof. So these two whiskeys are both at 80.
Okay.
So all the whiskeys that we've released so far, except for our Taiwan exclusive barrels, have been at 80 proof. We just didn't really have a lot available.
So the Taiwan exclusive, what's that?
I'm trying to remember. I think one was 105 and one was 90.
We did 95 for the hard and then 100 for the bourbon.
Boy, I tell you, that 100 or that 105 really interests me. I love those big whiskeys.
Yeah, and we're getting to the point where I think we can start releasing those. We just had such a limited amount. People were really... would get a little upset, especially if they put us on their cocktail list. When we have places like Nobu in Las Vegas that are pouring out of their well, that we need to be able to keep up, and everybody in Montana. So it was either higher proof, less quantity to go around, or drop the proof down to 80. And now we also have another area for barrel storage we're going through with the federal and feds and the state to get that approved for off-site storage, so then we can really start ramping up our
whiskey. Nice. Okay. How long does that process take with the feds?
It just all depends.
Yeah, probably.
So certain things like our hop schnapps that we did, we had product in barrels in bottles for well over a year before we got that label approved. Other things pretty quick.
I hope they come up with another term than hop schnapps. I think that's a derogatory term. I'd like it to be its own style of whiskey, even though we're using beer or whatever with it. I think it should have its own.
Ours isn't barrel aged.
Oh, it isn't?
No.
Okay.
So, and it's actually after we came up with that based off of an old distilling manual that I have from the 1860s. A friend of mine that was an antique dealer passed away and his son gave it to me. There was a reference in there to if you take beer and distill it, we call it beer schnapps. And yeah, it's...
What have we here? What's this one?
So this one, we have our 10th anniversary coming up. We've been having this one sit for quite a while. We've always wanted to do a bottled and bond spirit. So a whiskey at 100 proof. Minimum of 4 years in a barrel. This one, we're doing 5 years in a barrel. Right now, we're going to taste it at barrel proof, so it's at 110. We'll proof it back to 100. It'll be our first bottled in bond spirit.
That we'll have. Oh, yeah.
So it's a little hot, but this one you get...
brown sugar, big. This is like coffee cake.
Yep. And this is actually sat in a used, one of our ex-bourbon barrels. For that full 5 years.
So, is this an American whiskey, or is it a bourbon, or what is this?
You can't call it bourbon. It's corn whiskey.
It's corn whiskey.
Yep.
Okay.
100% corn into used cooperage.
You can't call it bourbon, because it is a used cask.
Yep.
All right, well, let's give this a try.
It's that nutty corn sweetness.
Mm,
at that high proof.
Oh, I like this.
Yes, absolutely. So very excited to get this one out.
We actually were going to release this last spring, and then everything happened. Didn't really know what to do with it, and didn't really think it was responsible to have a whole bunch of people lined up in front of our place waiting to get the bottle. So we're planning on doing that for sure. So.
Oh, this is nice.
And I love bottled bonds because there's just nothing to hide by. You know that it was distilled at that facility, that it was aged at that facility.
It's a nice vanilla cream in here. But it's, there's also a kind of like a caramel hard candy, but like a, almost like a clear one, not like a Werther's or something like that. But just really, really nice. Good job, guys.
Absolutely. So the next one we're gonna taste is actually an aged gin. So just recently, this past May, the TTB passed a rule that distilleries can now call rested gin, you can call it aged. So we've had this one up, it was 4 years this September. This one's kind of fun. So we do a pink peppercorn pear gin, which is our American style gin.
Which is lovely.
You know, typically gin, like a dry style gin, the gin's very prevalent, the juniper is very prevalent. With the pear gin, the juniper kind of takes a back seat. So people that typically don't like that gin flavor will usually go after the pear gin. So
there's 15 different botanicals, and it took us 2.5 years to get everything to balance out right on that recipe.
And tell me about the barrels that you're using for this. Is it a new barrel, or are they each used?
So this one's really cool. we have a great partnership with a local brewery up in Whitefish, Fallenside Brewing. We give them some of our used barrels after we harvest them. For this one, he does his, Sheriff Brown?
Sheriff John Brown.
John Brown. So it's a sour brown ale.
Wow.
For 13 months. And then we get the barrel back and went in with the peppercorn.
Very cool.
It's almost an Amaro like quality to it.
Yeah. But there's also like a like an Amaro.
Yeah.
Definitely, you know, the herbal European style of the cure, but there's something else in there too.
Very, very, very herbaceous.
At first, I was almost getting like a little amaretto, but it would just be like on the edges of it. That herbal comes back. It comes through in such a great way.
The finish on that, just at that 110, that high proof, it's crazy good. And like immediately, I think of...
This was definitely an experiment that we didn't know which way it was going to go. I haven't talked to anybody else who was doing aging in sour beer barrels, and...
This is fun. This is
so
easy
with talking.
I could see this definitely in a corpse reviver. This is the spice in this is just lovely. It's almost there's almost some holiday spices.
It could go right to Christmas.
Yeah. So, when do you think this one will be ready? Around then?
This is good. This is going to be end of 2020 for sure.
Yep. Okay.
So, hoping to have a barrel release for the holidays for right before our 10-year anniversary.
This, if I could, I would love to get a case of this. And I tell you, anybody who gets a bottle of this, that's one hell of a holiday gift, I gotta tell you. So yeah, it's such a good winter warmer, too. But, I mean, I could see this
with
like...
With cocktails, it's going to be fun to play with.
The con pie? Oh, God. With any kind of sweet potatoes with mushrooms... Oh, this would just be wonderful.
It's like gingerbread, like.
Oh, God.
Gingerbread.
Yeah.
I was tasting it. It's familiar. So this one, speaking of aged gins, this one's, we're definitely proud of this one. This one's actually our aged cucumber gin that we do in freshly harvested bourbon. So this one's been sitting in a barrel for 6.5 years.
Okay, so this is a gin.
This is our
cucumber gin. Okay.
So barrel-aged gins are becoming very popular now. Most people are doing 3 to 6 months of age. We went the other way. And that's...
I salute you for that. Thank you.
And it's based off of... I had a fantastic gin in Seattle at Great Park. Bathtub gin and Nelly, and they had a they had a spirit in their liquid pearls, and it was a 21-year-old aged gin from Scotland. And then that was kind of discontinued, and now they've started to re-release it at 12 years of age. But
wow.
It was just fantastic and kind of got me thinking about doing longer aging. I was really worried that the barrel would crush the cucumber on this, but that vanilla seems to have actually lifted it up.
There's
a little bit of a pickle quality to it.
There is. It's kind of a fluffy quality to it, a creamy thing. Was this the one that we had that had melon to it?
Yeah.
It kind of had a nice little melon, kind of almost like a melon sorbet or sherbet.
Like a honeydew.
Like a honeydew. But, man, I could see this. I could see having a glass of this with, like, some cantaloupe and prosciutto.
So this one,
that melon,
yeah,
massive, just honeydew. Oh my god!
This one I proofed back to 80, so this is at 80 proof, so it's not at the barrel proof. So a little lighter.
Okay.
But it is just as good.
Oh, it is. This is wonderful. This is a very easy drinking, sipping, just fruity. Lovely, you know, by itself, something to sip. I mean, you could even throw it back if you wanted to, and easily, but boy, tasty.
And starting with both of our gins, we had a great base to start with. So the cucumber gin, we won a gold medal from Denver International Spirit Competition, got some really great press on. The pink peppercorn and pear gin, we were actually featured in Wine Enthusiasts as one of the top 100 spirits in the world.
Nice.
And got some really great press on that as well. So starting from that base and then putting them in our used whiskey barrels, it really came out awesome.
Yeah. So what have we here?
So last but not least, so this is a fun little project that we are doing with our friends over at the Liquor Barn, which is the local state store here in Big Fork. They've always wanted to do a barrel pick with us, so we wanted to do something that we haven't done before, so something different. And we actually took a bourbon barrel, we harvested it, put that bourbon in an ex-rum cask. So this is a bourbon finish in a rum cask. So this is actually at 80 proof. This will be out next month. We're just really waiting for our labels to arrive.
The nose on this is amaretto marzipan.
Yeah.
It really is. That's that almond cream.
Very, very almond, nutty.
Oh, gosh, that's a lovely nose.
So I got the bourbon and some flavors.
Wow, have you thought about this for cocktails? Anything you're working with this?
We did a Whiskey West with the agave. So we played with instead of doing the same recipe, the whiskey, the agave, but doing like a chocolate bitters.
Ooh.
Is very good. Or like a black walnut, like a brown sugar flavor.
This is
milk punch.
Oh, very nice.
For the holidays, yeah.
Oh gosh, yes, I could definitely see that. You could also, this would be great with it, using that, having that, but also with a dessert, putting this in the whipped cream.
Yeah, there you go.
So you can complement the along with the drink. Oh, yeah, this is lovely.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's so much fun. We did tinker with liquor.
Well, guys, I got to thank you so much for helping us out with this, and it was so much fun being up here and talking with you guys. I understand that you've been helping out some of the local musicians around here during COVID, and if you could tell them what you've done to help out, and this is a very cool thing, folks. Please.
Yeah, this little setup that we're filming in right now actually came around during COVID. Some of the local musicians obviously didn't have places to play, needed to be able to pay their mortgages and keep up with everything, reached out, and we kind of set up a little spot where they could come in and just broadcast out their music, and with donations, everybody was able to keep their houses and keep their families fed and crunch through everything. So
that's
trying to do everything we can to help all our community.
The acoustics in here with the barrels is phenomenal.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
I was worried
to find out for that.
Yeah, kind of echoey, but all the musicians that came in said they absolutely loved it.
Yeah.
So.
That's such a great thing that you guys are doing that. And I know that there are other folks all over the state and the country that are trying to help out with folks that are not being able to make the rent or make some other things here in Montana. And what a wonderful thing to do to help out your community.
Absolutely.
Guys, again, thank you so much.
Thank you very much for coming.
I'm not sure where we're going to be next. Oh, my pleasure. I'm not sure where we're going to be next month, but we will be coming back to you again. Again, Kevin from the Rhino, please visit us at the Rhino in Missoula. Please, if you're up in Big Fork, stop by Whistling Andy's, and their products are wonderful. And hope to, well, we'll see you again in a month.
Awesome. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.